Tonight, we're going to be reading a passage that I think expresses God's passion for people. And I think it's not often read that way. So I want you to be patient with me as we go through this passage, and let's see if we can discover what God's passion is for people as we read Genesis 16 together. You'll know it as the passage of Hagar's flight from the home of Abram and Sarai. I'll read. Let's give attention to God's word. Now Sarai, Abram's wife, had borne him no children. She had a female Egyptian servant whose name was Hagar. And Sarai said to Abram, "Behold now, the Lord has prevented me from bearing children. Go into my servant. It may be that I shall obtain children by her." And Abram listened to the voice of Sarai. So after Abram had lived 10 years in the land of Canaan, Sarai, Abram's wife, took Hagar the Egyptian, her servant, and gave her to Abram, her husband, as a wife. And he went into Hagar, and she conceived. And when she saw that she had conceived, she looked with contempt on her mistress. And Sarai said to Abram, "May the wrong done to me be on you. I gave my servant to your embrace, and when she saw that she had conceived, she looked on me with contempt. May the Lord judge between you and me." But Abram said to Sarai, "Behold, your servant is in your power. Do to her as you please." Then Sarai dealt harshly with her, and she fled from her. The angel of the Lord found her by a spring of water in the wilderness, the spring on the way to Shur. And he said, "Hagar, servant of Sarai, where have you come from, and where are you going?" She said, "I'm fleeing from my mistress Sarai." The angel of the Lord said to her, "Return to your mistress and submit to her." The angel of the Lord also said to her, "I will surely multiply your offspring so that they cannot be numbered for multitude." And the angel of the Lord said to her, "Behold, you are pregnant. You shall bear a son. You shall call his name Ishmael, because the Lord has listened to your affliction. He shall be a wild donkey of a man, his hand against everyone and everyone's hand against him. And he shall dwell over against all his kinsmen." So she called the name of the Lord, the name of Yahweh, who spoke to her, "You are a God of seeing," or "You are a God seeing me." For she said, "Truly here, I've seen him who looks after me." Therefore the well was called Beer Lahai Roy. It lies between Kadesh and Bered. And Hagar bore Abram a son, and Abram called the name of his son, whom Hagar bore, Ishmael. Abram was 86 years old when Hagar bore Ishmael to Abram. The word of the Lord. And Father, send your spirit. We know he is here, for we have seen the evidence of him here tonight. But now would you take your word, bring it to the hearts of your people, that we may love your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. We may love him, and through him love you. Amen. When I was a young father, perhaps like other dads here, I used to get distracted from my kids. Well, my youngest daughter would have none of that. And she used to come up to my chair where I was studying, and she would literally, physically take my face between her two hands, and she would reorient me to her. And in her best three-year-old English, she would say, "Daddy, look at me." That memory has come home to me many times throughout my ministry. You know, this story feels like an old Middle Eastern story, doesn't it? An ancient Middle Eastern story. It's got all the elements of a good Middle Eastern story: polygamy, competition among the wives, factitiousness, expulsion. But actually, this story tells of a God who sees a woman who I am convinced she never thought she would be the object of anyone's affection. And here she is, confronted on the desert road by the living God, and she names him. She says, Ata El Ru'i, you are a God seeing me. She's overwhelmed. She can't believe that this God in heaven would take notice. She's the only person, would you believe it? She's the only person in all the pages of Scripture to name deity. So let's take a look at this story. We're going to take it apart bit by bit. And you just follow with me. If you have your Bibles open, it would be great if you can just follow along. The first character is Sarai. The commentators will tell us that what Sarai did actually parallels what Eve did in Genesis 3, that she took Hagar, much as Eve took the fruit. She gave Hagar to her husband, much as Eve gave the fruit to her husband, and Abram went into her. He listened to the voice of his wife, much as Adam did. And it does seem that there is a censure, there is a blaming of what Abraham did here in this text. But let's take another angle on it, because those who studied the ancient Near East tell us that what Sarai did was not at all wrong. In fact, it was expected of her. It was a noble choice. Abraham had come back to the tent so many times, and he had talked about his conversations with Yahweh, how Yahweh had told him that his descendants would be as many as the stars of the heaven, that he would have a son, his very own son, not Eliezer, his servant, and that this son would multiply and fill the earth. And now Sarai's in her 70s. What is she to do? I mean, the way of women has ceased with her. That's putting it politely. And so she did what she thought was right, I think. She took her servant and she gave her to her husband. Now, Sarai is not totally selfless in this, is it? Is she? She hopes to obtain children. The Hebrew says, I hope to be built up. And there's a play on words because built in Hebrew sounds a lot like sons. And so she's hoping that through this slave girl of hers, she will obtain children, secure the heir for her aging husband, and a future for her family. That's Sarai. Think for me a minute about Hagar. We know that she's from Egypt, probably procured by the family during their sojourn in Egypt. She's now lived in Canaan 10 years. She could have been taken in by the family when she was preteens. But let's assume that probably she's in her 20s. Hagar, for these 10 years, has been a means. She's been a slave. Her energy has not been her own. Her time doesn't belong to her. Her body is at the disposal of another. And now her womb is useful only to sire the family heir. Nothing belongs to her, not even her own body. And I wonder, you know, we think of this as a point of honor for her that she bore Ishmael, and the text does bear that out later. But when, as a young woman, she was given into the text literally says, into the lap of this 80-year-old man, as a 20-something-year-old woman. Now I wonder what she was feeling. And I wonder what she was thinking. If this was the last vestige of her freedom, that she nourished the hope that she might have a happy family and be a mother of her own children, and that hope now demolished. The deed is done. Tell you a little bit about Middle Eastern weddings. You know, they're grand affairs. There's always singing, there's always dancing, there's always that special hurdle that the women do. There's celebration, but there's something more than that because the wedding guests stay for the honeymoon night. In lots of places in the Middle East, that's still done today. And they stand very politely outside the tent or outside the apartment, and they wait for news that the marriage has been consummated physically. Sounds like the ultimate invasion of privacy, doesn't it? But that's done, and it's still done today. But you don't get any of the sense of that here, do you? In fact, if there was anyone waiting outside, you know who it was? The mistress, Sarai. There she was. The deed was done. Hagar conceives. And she finally, after 10, at least 10 long years of servitude, she has a point of pride, a little bit of leverage over her mistress. And in Hebrew it says, she looked on her lightly with her eyes. Body language. Middle Easterners are very good at it, as our commissioned missionaries will know soon if they don't know already. She looked on her lightly with her eyes. And what happened? Sarai, the confident matriarch of God's chosen people. No, not at all. The wounded woman whose purpose for life has been taken from her goes to her husband and she says, may the violence be done to me be on you. I gave her to you and now look what's happened. She despises me. And Abraham, also not as the confident provider, protector of his wife, says to Sarai, she's under your hand. Do with her as seems right to you. Now, the hand doesn't actually show up in the verse in English. Abram said to Sarai, behold, your servant is in your power. But in Hebrew, it's very clear, she's under your hand. And that's important because the hand is going to show up again in this text. And she treats Hagar harshly. Now, in the chapter just before that, God has spoken to Abraham about the future of his chosen people. And God has told Abraham that those people are going down to Egypt where they will be afflicted for 400 years. It's the same word. The affliction of the Hebrew people in Egypt now is doled out by the Hebrew matriarch to the Egyptian servant. And the word doesn't just mean verbal abuse. It could very well mean physical abuse. We don't like to think of Sarai in that way. We don't like to think of that happening in Abraham's house. But it seems it did, because she took to flight. And when we find Hagar, we find her pregnant with no male protector. Now, it sounds very sexist in our society, but in that society, it was absolute necessity to have a male who would accompany you. And she's on a desert road between a home that was the home of her slavery and a home that is long lost to her but probably deeply longed for. Hagar, lost, tattered, torn. It is this fight between Hagar and Sarai, this fight that leads to this flight. Now, I'd like to stop in my story here for just a moment and make a connection, because it's important. It's important for these folks who have been commissioned here. It's important for me. And you'll forgive me if I talk a little bit about the context I come from. We know that Hagar bears Ishmael, and Ishmael becomes the symbolic father of the Arab peoples. Now, a little secret is that that's probably not true in terms of their biology, their DNA. It's probably not true in terms of their history. The Arabs today are a huge amalgamation of many peoples, and even the Arabs of biblical times came from different streams. Nevertheless, the founder of Islam traced his roots back through Ishmael to Abraham. And so Ishmael becomes the symbolic father of the Arab peoples. Will you think with me for just a moment about this country that we hear so much about in the news? Think of them today. Pre-war, the country of Syria was 21 million people. Today, 6 years after the outbreak of war, 5 million of those people are exiled. They're outside the country. 6.5 million are internally displaced. Would you believe that 1 in every 10 Syrians is wounded, maimed, or dead because of the Syrian war? These sons and daughters of Hagar and Ishmael are in flight. They're destitute. They have nothing. They're on the desert road. Who will meet them? Who will be there? They're showing up in places like this in the Baca Valley where I live in Lebanon. Kids in tents, rows of tents between potato fields, playing with their hula hoops. But each one of them beautiful in their own way. Each one of them, as you get to know them, you find they have the very same aspirations you do. They want their kids to have an education. They want to live with dignity. They want to prepare the food that they love. They want to live in security. It's uncanny to me that this flight of Hagar began with her exalting herself, finally getting this place of pride and honor that she holds over Sarai. You know, you've heard about the Arab Spring, right? The yearning of the Arab peoples for democracy, the taking to the streets, these popular uprisings. And there was such hope on the street in the Arab world. But today, the Arab Spring has turned into a long, perennial winter with no end in sight. And I talked to my Syrian friends, and I asked them, do you ever think of going back? And they just say, there's no hope. What will we go back to? Halab, Aleppo. It's in ruins. It's destroyed. Where will we go? So, brothers and sisters, it's not just Hagar who's in flight. It's also the sons and daughters of Hagar today. The fight led to a flight, but also there is a finding here that leads to a future. It starts in verse 7, and it says, the angel of the Lord found her. Now, I want to just ask you, who is this angel of the Lord? When I was a young boy, there was in my grandmother's bedroom, there was a picture over the guest bed of a long, flowing, robed angel with wings extending out her back as she ushered two kids across a rickety bridge. And that was my concept of angels, and I bet it's some of yours as well. But that is not who this person is. And if you think of that person as this glowing being, I want to ask you to change your idea. Because in verse 13, the narrator tells us, she called the name of Yahweh, who spoke to her, you are a God of seeing, or you are a God seeing me. So both the narrator, the writer of this story, and Hagar thought they were talking to God. To Almighty God. Now, I thought it might be important that we take a look at our Reformed heritage here. So I brought you a quote of John Calvin. I thought that would please everybody. Now, he's not talking about this particular instance. He's talking about the angel of the Lord in another instance. But he says, let us inquire who this angel was. The ancient teachers of the church rightly understood it to be the eternal Son of God. In respect to his office as mediator. Calvin, in one stroke of his pen, summarized the whole history of the fathers of the church. All of them, I think unanimously, thought of the angel of the Lord as the pre-incarnate Christ, an appearance of Jesus before his birth. But you know, we don't need John Calvin, or John Owen, by the way, who thought the same thing, or Jonathan Edwards, by the way, who thought the same thing. Because we have in the New Testament this word that no one has seen God at any time. The only begotten who's in the bosom of the Father, he has declared him. So that's why, or he has made him known, that's why the fathers of the church thought that when this angel appeared, we should see in him Jesus. And Jesus himself said some of the most astounding things, didn't he, when he talked to the Pharisees? He said to them once, "You don't believe Moses." Can you imagine telling the Pharisees they don't believe Moses? "Because Moses wrote about me. If you believe Moses, you believe me." Wow. And then he said to them again later in John 8, he said, "Abraham rejoiced to see my day." He saw it and was glad. He came back after his resurrection, Jesus did, and he said to his disciples, as we know in Luke 24, "All that was written about me in the Psalm, the law, and the prophets and the Psalms, all that was written had to be fulfilled." So Jesus very much saw himself as central to the Old Testament. I want to suggest to you that when you read this story, as though Jesus were encountering Hagar, it's going to make a difference to you. You're going to read it differently. So what does he do? He finds her, first of all. And that word, we need to just stop there for a minute and take note. This is a very common word in the Old Testament, but it's not commonly used of God finding. And whenever it's used of God finding, it's election, it's salvation that's at stake here. God finds Israel as a wild vine. He transplants that vine into a fertile ground and tends it and cares for it himself. He finds David. He takes him from behind the sheep and he places him upon the throne of Messiah. This is the finding of God in the Old Testament. So when God, the eternal Son of God, finds Hagar here, we need to be thinking election and salvation. But then he also asks her two questions. He says, calls her by name. She's not been called by name yet in this text. We only know that because the author tells us her name is that. She's always called the servant of Sarai. He calls her by name and he says, "Hagar, servant of Sarai, where have you come from? Tell me your history. Tell me what brought you here. Tell me. And where are you going? Tell me your dreams. Tell me what you're longing for. Tell me your direction in life, Hagar." Isn't it stunning when you think that the pre-incarnate Christ met with this fleeing Arab woman and said to her, "Where have you come from? And where are you going? Tell me about yourself." Well, she knew the answer to the first question. She said, I'm running away. I'm getting out of here. I'm running from Sarai. But she had no clue about the answer to the second question. And so the angel begins to unfold that answer. And I want you to hang with me here because some of this may differ from what you've heard in the past. I don't know. First thing he says to her, there are five words. I'm going through them very quickly. "Return to your mistress and submit to her." Here again, we see this expression of the hand. He says to her, "The hand that oppressed you, that afflicted you, that caused you to suffer, I want you to return. I want you to place yourself under that hand." It's a hard word. I think of it. I liken it to Jesus' words to his disciples. "If any man would come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me." This is Hagar's discipleship. You are to go back and place yourself under the hand that oppressed you and afflicted you. You are to trust in me, Hagar. The second word, he says this amazing sentence. He says to her this, "I will surely multiply your offspring so that they cannot be numbered for multitude." Now, think about it a minute. There were no televisions or mobile phones or what have you to entertain oneself with in those days. So I'm wondering if Abraham came back from his encounters with Yahweh and he said, "Guess what?" As the servants gathered around the fire, "Guess what? He told me I'm going to have a son. It's going to be my very own son. And my son is going to fill the earth. It's going to be as many as the stars in the heaven. Can you believe it, Sarah? Can you believe it?" And Hagar recognizes this, and I think we should recognize it as God's rich language of covenantal blessing. He intends to pour out blessing on this woman. utterly unique in Scripture that this kind of promise would be given to a woman. And then she tells him, or sorry, he tells her a little bit more. He says in this third word, "Behold, you are pregnant, and you will bear a son." We know the gender of this boy now, this child. "Because Yahweh has listened, you shall call his name Ishmael, because Yahweh has listened to your affliction." You'll know that when Lord is in all caps, it's Yahweh, right? I'm just putting that in there so we make sure we know who we're talking about. Now, we don't know if Hagar prayed at all, do we? But what did Yahweh hear? He heard the affliction. Picture him hearing her moans, hearing her distress, seeing her disorientation as she's fleeing. Those cries of hers ascend to God in heaven, and the angel of the Lord descends to her, and he says, "Name this boy Yishmael. God is listening." And forever, when she looks at this little boy, she's going to say, "God's listening. Come here, God's listening." Yeah, isn't that beautiful? It's stunning. It's amazing. It's the gospel to this woman. God has heard her. Now, the next words, a little bit more problematic, aren't they? Let's look at this fourth word. It comes in two phrases. "He shall be a wild donkey of a man." Everybody's chuckling. Why are you guys chuckling? "His hand against everyone and everyone's hand against him." All right, here's what I think this says. When you and I think of a donkey, of course, we think of a stubborn, obstinate, and stupid beast of burden, right? Let's just get it out there. That's what we think of. And so, is it that Yahweh has now done an about-face? And instead of blessing her, he's now pronouncing a curse. I'm telling you, I was with a worker, a missionary in an Arab country, and he said to me, "You know, this is a curse. This is the curse of Ishmael." I wonder if some here think that tonight. Let me show you, just put up here, what a Jewish commentator says about this, and he's not alone. He says, "Like the wild donkey among the beasts, so are the Ishmaelites among men. In their nature and destiny, they call to mind the sturdy, fearless, and fleet-footed Syrian onager, Pere in Hebrew, who inhabits the wilderness and is almost impossible to domesticate." Now, it turns out that the domesticated beast of burden that's stupid and stubborn is not a pere, he's a hamar, same word that we use in Arabic. But this is not that animal. This is a related animal, but it's the desert donkey. I first encountered him when I was reading pre-Islamic poetry in Arabic. Aren't you glad you don't have to do that? But they always use the animals as symbols, and this animal, this desert donkey, was a symbol of robust independence. It was an animal that refused to be domesticated. It was an animal that clung tenaciously to its freedom, and it lived in the desert. So I think this is what God, the angel of the Lord, is saying to Hagar. And I'm not alone in this. You can look at Tony Maalouf's good book called Arabs in the Shadow of Israel, and he will prove to you, I think, what I'm saying. But the second phrase as well, his hand against everyone and everyone's hand against him. Now, this is 9 or 10 words in English, but in Hebrew it's 5. It's very succinct. His hand against all, everyone's hand against him. Now, I told you, his hand has popped up twice in this passage already. Both times, it's an image of servitude and being subjugated and being under the power of someone. But here, it says that this man, Ishmael, will not be under the hand. He will resist the hand, and he will stubbornly throw off the hand that attempts to domesticate him. Ishmael will be a desert wanderer, a freedom lover, a man of independence. You, Hagar, return to your life of servitude. As for Ishmael, he will cast off the fetters of slavery, and he will be free and independent. I think that's the way Hagar heard this. Now, I told you at the beginning, this is an old story. We need some help to understand it. And if you have understood this story in another way, perhaps it has clouded your vision for the nations. Perhaps you have been guilty, as many have, of saying that there will be perpetual warfare in the Middle East because the good book says so. That's what it says. But the good book is not saying that about Ishmael, brothers and sisters. It's not saying that about him. It's saying he will be free. He will be independent. He will be blessed. And then that next phrase, the last one, the fifth word, he will dwell over against all his kinsmen. Now, NIV translate that, he will live in hostility to all his brothers. But the word is just, he'll be before the face. And that's all it need to mean. He will be opposite them. And in Genesis 25, by the way, Abraham, when he's told that Sarai will have the son, it's not going to be Ishmael. He says, oh, that Ishmael might live before you. God says, no, the promise will come through Isaac, but I've heard your prayer. And Ishmael also will be blessed, uniquely blessed. He will be the father of 12 princes. Genesis 25 lists those 12 princes. You can follow their history through the Bible. And it is predicted in Isaiah that they will come bringing gifts of tribute to the Messiah. It's predicted in the pages of Scripture. And at the end of that passage in Genesis 25, it says, he dwelt in the desert of Paran. It's that extensive desert right across southern Israel and the Sinai Peninsula and parts of Jordan and Saudi Arabia. So that was Ishmael's promised land. That was where he was to dwell, over, not among his brothers, the Jews, but over against them, opposite them. So let me just summarize here. I'm almost through. The eternal Son of God is in pursuit of a woman that is torn and tattered and confused and disoriented. He gives her a promise. He gives her a name of a child that says to her, I've heard you. He gives her a promise that says, you are to return to be a servant, but never fear, your son will break the chains of servitude. He will have his own land. I have a future for you, Hagar, and for your son, Ishmael. Now let me just briefly show you. These are the sons of Ishmael today. This is a church gathering in our lovely city of Beirut. You will notice that woman in the middle wearing the Muslim headscarf. It's becoming very common for these new brothers and sisters to show up among us. In fact, these church gatherings, I hope you can see that. This is almost all women here in this gathering. You can see how many headscarves are there. Every headscarf is a Muslim woman. Now, if you had told me, I said this to our brother Greg Livingston and Sally, who's given his life for this cause. If you had asked me to predict 6 years ago at the outset of the Syrian war, what would be the result, I would never have said Syrian Sunni Muslims and Kurdish Muslims will be pouring into evangelical churches in Beirut. I would have never said that. But it's happening. And there are entire meetings dedicated to Syrian Muslims who are coming and raising their hands in praise and worship and hearing the word of God taught in our tiny little evangelical churches in Beirut, of all places. Take a look at this picture. I can't see it too well, but that church is filled with Muslims. And you know what? The guy standing up on the podium, guess who sent him out? World Outreach. That's Nur Butrus, husband of Rebecca Butrus from the first pres, I think in Baton Rouge, if I'm not mistaken. And there he is, Syrian guy, sharing with his own people the wonders of Jesus right there. I took one of my former students, or he took me actually, down to this area of Beirut, and we sat around in a circle. There were 15 women there, about half of them wearing the Muslim headscarf. It was such a blessing. He masterfully led this Discovery Bible study, and these women were eating it up. They love this Jesus. Now, all that they know about him, they love him. And I looked just across from me. There was this woman of fine features. She was wearing a very formal galabiya, sort of the long black robe that she wears, and she had on the colorful headscarf. And she looked at me with those features, and she smiled. None of the hardness, you know, that some of us think of in Muslim women. And there was a little child with chubby cheeks and curly locks in a stroller between the two of us. And he would occasionally whimper during the Bible study. She would just put her foot on his stroller, rock him back and forth. He'd go back to sleep, and she would dig back into the Word of God. And I looked at her, and I said, yes, Jesus is still pursuing Hagar. He's still after her. He's out to find her. But he's not meeting her as an angel, a pre-incarnate appearance, but he's meeting her through the Spirit animated body of Christ reaching out to Muslims in love. Brothers and sisters, if we are terrorized by Islam, devil won, it's over. Game's over, it's done. If we are terrorized, if we are fearful, if we are scared, because you know what? These people are terrorized, fearful, and scared. They are the victims. They are the victims. You and I must receive our marching orders from Christ. We must tune out the pundits and, if need be, the politicians. And we must act as Jesus commands us to act. We must be the people who pursue. And these Muslim people are coming to your own towns and cities. I know, because I spent 5 years in Knoxville. We had a whole wave of Iraqi refugees, and I was so proud of my church, how they responded to those people. So I'm confident in the church. You can do it. You say, well, we don't have the language. We don't know the culture. But just start here. Tell me, where have you come from? And where are you going? You just take those two questions with you tonight. And just as he did a little pursuing, you do a little pursuing as well. I think it's time, brothers and sisters. I think it's time for Muslims to hear the truth of the gospel. It's time. Jesus says, you know, he had this habit of showing up with distressed women by water sources, didn't he? He did it in the old, he did it in the new. And in the new, he said to his disciples, and I think he's saying it to me first of all, and to you as well tonight. He said, lift up your eyes and look on the harvest fields, for they're wide unto harvest. The problem is not there. The problem is here. And here, it's how we see. It's how we understand. It's how we obey. Let us pray. Father, we want to hear the word of Jesus. We really want to. We want to follow him in his pursuit of the nations. And Father, it's not because these people are worthy or because they're needy or because they're ragged or beat up or torn or distressed. It's because Jesus is worthy of all the nations of the world. We confess that. May his bride be complete. And we say, oh Father, take us and use us. Send out hundreds more from our midst. Send out thousands more from your church. And Father, may Jesus receive the glory he deserves among the nations of the world. Amen.